It's kind of a rough night. I have a family moment with a possible passing. So my dad is kind of stressed out, and I'm gonna be the holding down the fort for him. I guess what I was gonna actually talk about was about, as time goes on in our lives, how we're losing our ability to rebound and to humor more and more. And oddly, as I've been reading about all these things, as we age, we are losing our humor. Giving serotonins anymore when you hit 65, so it's even worse. So as we go and go and go and go, we start losing. So actually, I have some humor time, but a lot of you don't have humor time anymore, and it makes life such a doldrum, because there's just the stagnation of life. You're going through, this is happening, that's happening, and then there's the bills, and then there's this type of work or that type of work, and then this person may be dying, or this person has died, and all of this is going on, and there's no humor associated, because you've reached like a time that it just can't bounce out of you anymore. You can say, well, you've been hit too hard your whole life, you don't have it, you've had too many falls of lifetime dramas, so you don't have a rebound, or it's not your personality. But what it does is it just becomes less and less and less, you know, the 400 smiles. I think it was like 400 a day for an infant goes down to like nothing. So we smile less and less and less, and so it makes it difficult. It almost makes it, it's like we're just like, you're just going to be a problem, and I'm going to avoid you, and you're over there going to be a problem, and I'm going to avoid you. Because you're older and you're filled with that weight of sagas, the weight of sadnesses, the weight, that doldrum, that stagnation. Your exuberance is gone, your joie de vivre, all of those things missing. Yeah, and so we end up more and more in this really isolated situation because of, well, and unless you're really good at the farcity of life, unless you're good at being a farce, like people go to these church gatherings or whatever, and they're kind of varsity type. All of that contented turn on. I've turned on my contented face, or I just see a stranger on the street, and I just want to say hello. And but it's still that shallow hello. It's not anything of real true meaning. And that really becomes your contentment, happiness place. It starts to be these shallow moments, these shallow notifications, like, that's interesting, I think that looks nice, I think that painting over there is very interesting to look at. Those shallow notifications become our only contentment drum. When in reality, is that depth? Is that a depth of meaning moment? To see a house and go, oh, I like the paint job on that house. Is that a moment of real abundance? You know what I'm saying? Abundance within. Yeah. So anyway, my aunt, yeah, she's really maybe her last night. So it's tough. And I went out and I looked on the cosmos and said, was there anything happening? And Venus is passing. It's going through some kind of, it's not around anymore. It's heading back towards the sun. So that was about it. And then there was maybe 5 days ago of interesting showers, meteor showers. But yeah, there hasn't been anything. Not a big comet like Halley's going by, anything like that. But I'm just trying to deal with the fact that the shallow happy, like we have the shallow happy, and then we have what is that other happy if it's not shallow? The other one is gone, you know. Just the exuberant self is you know, something somebody was saying about that, you know, there's a dancing butterfly and then you go around and you dance with it. You know, all of those those spontaneous moments, they're gone. You don't want to do them anymore. It's just like the weight, life weight has become too heavy. So you can't just run out and sing in the rain. You know, those moments are gone. And it's like, and the only replacement is that distinguishment of, I really like that house. I like the way the bricks are laid on the front, or I think that's very intriguing, how they made their driveway. I really, really enjoy that vehicle, that car has some real, it really gives me something, you know, to look at it or to own it. And so your self has been, it's like your contentment now has turned into the materialistic view. Maybe I'm just content and I saw something materialistic, and that materialism, whether I own it or not, or saw it on TV, that materialism is my gain moment of happiness. I saw that somebody drove by in a Ferrari and it was a beautiful color. So that's a gain moment of happiness for me. You know, those types of odd, you know, that becomes the new contentment. I'm thinking that's another shallow, isolated, and it's an isolated shallow of each person. You know, they're going through it, and oddly, that is a group phenomenon. You know, there becomes a group consensus, like that car, or a type of clothing, or that type of hairstyle. You know, all of these are, we're in agreement, and so there's an agreement, a contented agreement moment. So we're having contentment. But it's not the exuberant contentment of let's just go out and dance like butterflies. Or when I was younger, we used to be silly, just leaping in the streets, you know, dumb. But we used to do things like that. Those types of childish things where there's no parent, there's just nothing, there's no adult. It's just you having your freedom of expression. You're not conservative, yeah. Your freedom of expression. So now I'm like, well, how do I combat that? I can full paint the house. That's something interesting. I can take the walls and paint on them. That would fight it. We do have to fight it. We have to fight that we are not these materialistic contentment reward machines, like our Pavlov dog. You know, we get our reward. We saw another materialism item that was intriguing, and so I feel rewarded. You know, I had my lozenge or reward of wow, I saw something made, built, created that was very expensive or very high quality, you know. So that's my new happy self. Even though it may or may not be mine, you know. So those types of contentments really seem to become our contentments as we age. And I don't know. They do seem, some of them seem petty, don't they? They seem petty, they seem small, they seem like maybe they're not the full on enriched contentments, you know what I mean? They're not enriched enough. They're more like just choice agreements. You know, I agree with that is pretty, and I agree with that is not, you know. So they're like a choice agreement, contentment. And so I'm in that choice agreement, contentment group. And so then there's a sigh of relief, like that's your new socialization, your new church, is that we all like that painting. We all like abstract art. We all dislike abstract art, you know, so there's that choice group. So yeah, we end up with a separation, because I was reading they were having anti-Semitism issues, and I'm like, well, that can stop, you know, right away. If we have more people take those ancestry tests, you'll find out you might be Jewish, and that's kind of funny. So, yeah, if most people could find out just 1%, that would be amazing. And then we wouldn't have any all that garbage, all that hatred. But so here we're at this contentment group. Now I'm going to say they like the abstract painting, or they like the non-abstract paintings only. They only see if it's a realist art is a real artist, and that's where they sit with their opinion. And with that opinion, that becomes their new happiness. So opinions become more are happy. And then we fight for those opinions, you know, we get argumentative over those opinions, you know, this is the way it is, you know. So these unfortunately, the one thing that, you know, was a moment of happiness, it ends up being a power trip. Okay, so we have the power trip with the choice decision, You know, I have the choice decision of only liking realism art, and none of that, anything else, nothing strange, nothing surreal, nothing modern, nothing contemporary, nothing, certainly nothing trivial, like I would draw, paint. It has to be straight up on the board. I have to see mountains, I have to see trees, I have to see rivers, lakes, streams, and birds. I have to see that, and then that's classed as an artist. Okay, so you have that, and the person is oddly deriving, you know, from that decision. There's contentment in holding that decision. But it sure is a tough one. It's a tough contentment, you know, to keep that choice as your new revel in happiness. That's where you keep your happiness lives, is in your interests and how they apply to you. I don't know if this is helping anybody at all, but it's just an observation. The scramble of, I wanted to just laugh and be giddy and fun, but that's not around, and so I'm just trying to analyze why, and I'm finding I am mildly content by certain things, you know, materialistic things, but yeah, all of these, you know, that I've been talking about, they apply to me also. Anyway, ay ay ay, death, passings, and all of that are rough time. Oh yeah, I have a tummy ache. What is it? It's 1:30, 2:30, and I don't know. I hope they're okay. You know, I didn't go because I just, you know, enough people. But yeah, she will be missed, and what was I'm sorry, my head, I have a whole bunch of things spinning through right now. I have Pythagoras, Pythagorean theorem, remember him in school? Back to vegans. Well, Pythagoras was before BC, and he was like about 500 years before BC, and he was in a mathematics group of mathematicians, very famous school, and they were not allowed to eat meat in their school, the mathematician school. So here is something I'm deriving my contentment with this bit of information. Oh my gosh, and he did write quite a bit about the future and how we're not going to eat meat any longer. He wrote things about that, and so he was kind of into they've got to change, they've got to stop. He was saying that way back then. They forced them. They did not want that meat eating going on. Something to do with their brains functioning and mathematics. So very, very interesting. Very interesting. Anyway, so that's how I'm going to end it. But yeah, with that little bit of trivia, that information, you know, here I'm grabbing information out of a book or off this internet. There's a contentment hall. That's a different type of happiness, though. It's not that exuberance, but that's about as far as it gets, you know, the older we get, you know, a little bit. I got information that applies in my direction. So I have a little bit of an exuberance lift by little Pythagoras and his mathematician school. All right. Oh, he did get a few things wrong. About the orbit of the he was that the earth was round. He got that part right. He was the earth round guy, but he did say that everything orbits around us, and so he did get that wrong. That's okay. That's all right. Okay, guys, that's all. And anyway, love to my aunt, and send her the best out to her heavens where she goes. Okay. Good night.